Big thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. If someone points out to you that your pet theory of the universe is in disagreement with Maxwell's equations, then so much the worse for Maxwell's equations. If it is found to be contradicted by observation, well, these experimentalists do bungle things sometimes. But if your theory is found to be against the second law of thermodynamics, then I can give you no hope. There is nothing for it but to collapse in deepest humiliation. This is what Arthur Eddington, a very important British astrophysicist, said about the second law of thermodynamics. In this video, we'll understand exactly what this second law says, and the two simple assumptions that build up to the theory of statistical mechanics, which is basically thermodynamics on a very small scale. If you enjoyed this video, then please hit the thumbs up button and subscribe for more fun physics content. Let's get into it. There are a few different ways to understand the second law of thermodynamics, all of which are basically equivalent to each other. But in my opinion, the simplest statement of this law says that thermal energy does not spontaneously go from a colder object to a hotter object. Basically, if we have two objects, A and B, at different temperatures, and then we connect them together, then thermal energy will flow from the hotter object to the cooler object until they both reach thermal equilibrium at some temperature between their initial temperatures. Like I mentioned, there are a lot of different statements of the second law of thermodynamics, and I'll leave some links in the description box below that discuss these other statements in more detail. One of the interesting things about this law, though, is that it deals with a quantity called entropy. For the purposes of this video, we can think of entropy as a measure of disorder. To understand this, let's say that we're studying a system made up of some tennis balls. And these tennis balls can be placed on two different surfaces, each at different heights, on the ground or on a table. Let's say that in one case, we're studying our system where all the balls must be on the ground. Well, there's only one way to arrange this system. The three balls must be on the ground. This is a very ordered system. Let's keep that in mind. I'm going to label this number of arrangements with the Greek letter omega. This will come in handy later as well. It's the possible number of ways in which we can arrange our system. Now let's say we have a system where one of the balls can be on the table while the other two must be on the ground. This time we can arrange the system in slightly different ways. Either ball A and B are on the ground and C is on the table, or B is on the table and A and C are on the ground, or A is on the ground and B and C are on the table. In other words, there are three ways to arrange our system such that one of the balls is on the table and two are on the ground. Here, omega is equal to 3. We would probably say that this is a more disordered system than the previous one, since that one was very neat, whereas this one has a stray ball ruining the neatness. And this value, omega is equal to 3, is bigger, so this directly corresponds to a higher entropy value, as we'll see later. This, broadly speaking, is why we say that entropy is a measure of disorder. More on that in this video up here. Now, before we continue, I want to take a moment to talk about Brilliant, the sponsor of this video. I am a huge fan of lifelong learning and of well-designed learning materials that take all the faff away from learning. Well, Brilliant.org is the best way to learn maths and computer science interactively. Brilliant has thousands of lessons for all different levels of understanding, so you can start where you feel comfortable and quickly progress from there. Personally, I really like the quantum mechanics course designed by Sabina Hossenfelder, who is a brilliant scientist and also has a wonderful YouTube channel that I'm sure many of you are already familiar with. The excellent course design, coupled with Brilliant's focus on interactive content and simple, clear, visual design, make learning an absolute joy. There's nothing quite like learning by playing around with learning materials, and Brilliant does this brilliantly. Most importantly, their lessons build analytical skills as well. So, if you want to try out everything that Brilliant has to offer for free for 30 days, visit brilliant.org/parthg or click the link in the description. The first 200 of you to do so will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription. Seriously, go check it out. Helps the channel out and you'll get to do some fun learning on Brilliant. Thanks once again to Brilliant. Now let's get back to the video. Okay, so this contrived system that I came up earlier with tennis balls placed either on the ground or on the table is a much simplified version of systems we can study when we learn statistical mechanics. Specifically, when we study things like gases, it turns out that we can understand them as being made up of lots of particles, with each particle having a specific amount of energy. To keep things simple, let's consider a gas made up of three particles. Each of these particles has some amount of energy, for example, 3E, where E is some unit of energy that doesn't particularly matter to us. We can represent this using an energy level diagram like this. These energy level diagrams are useful for a couple of different reasons. Firstly, they genuinely represent what gases and other systems behave like on a small scale. Each particle can really only have a specific value of energy, basically because of quantum mechanics. Check out this video if you'd like to know more about this idea. And secondly, because we can represent many particles in, for example, a gas, even if they're really far spread out in real life. All we care about here are the energy values of each particle, so we can just represent them on this diagram without worrying about their spatial positions in real life. Here's another interesting thing. When particles in the gas interact with each other, they can basically transfer energy to each other. So let's say that these two particles are moving towards each other, one with energy 4e and another with energy e. When they interact, the 4e particle can now give, say, 1 unit of energy to the e particle. Now the particles have 3e and 2e units of energy, respectively. The total energy of the gas found by adding up all of the particle energies is still the same as it was before, because the gas is not interacting with anything else outside of itself. But the energies of the particles themselves can change as they interact with each other. And here we come to one of the basic assumptions of statistical mechanics. It's known as the principle of equal a priori probabilities. Complicated name, but basically, it just says that for a given total energy of the system, with all other things being equal, the system is equally likely to be found in any of these possible microstates, or any possible microstates for that matter. For example, if the system has a total energy of 4e, then it's equally likely that particle A is in the 2e state and the others are in e state, as it is that B is in 2e, as it is that particle C is in 2e. Basically, if all the particles are the same as each other, then there is no preference for which particle is in the 2e state. It could be any of them, and it's equally likely that any of them are in the 2e state. Put this way, our statement seems kind of obvious, because why wouldn't it be? But it's an important distinction to make when we start considering higher energies and much larger number of particles, as we would have to if we were studying a real gas, then it becomes less obvious. Additionally, as we've seen already, our gas will actually be switching back and forth between these microstates over time because of interactions between particles and the exchange of energy. By the way, notice that there's no 0e energy state. This is another principle of quantum mechanics, where the lowest possible energy of each particle is not zero. In many systems, we deal with the lowest possible energy, which is known as the vacuum fluctuation, and any particle that theoretically would have zero energy would basically be at a temperature of absolute zero, which, according to thermodynamics, is not possible. More detailed information in the resources linked in the description. Also, a quick reminder that if you're enjoying this video so far, then please hit like and subscribe for more fun physics content. Anyway, so we've seen the first assumption used to build up the theory of statistical mechanics, the principle of equal a priori probabilities. The second assumption is a little bit more interesting, in my opinion, because it links properties of our small-scale view of the system, where we deal with energies of individual particles, with large-scale properties of the whole system, such as the volume, or the temperature, or the pressure of the, in this case, gas. Remember, our gas will be fluctuating between all the possible microstates over time, due to thermal fluctuations and transfer of energy between its particles. And it turns out that each of these microstates can be linked to a particular large-scale property of the gas. For example, particles in this microstate would, based on some initial configuration of the particles from way back when he started looking at the gas, result in the overall gas having a particular volume or a particular pressure. And each of these microstates will have a different or possibly the same value, but each of them can be assigned a value of these properties. This volume or pressure or temperature is a measure of the entire gas, which is what we deal with in real life, because most systems are too complex with way too many particles to measure individual particles or microstates. Also, the switch between many microstates over a short period of time due to thermal fluctuations occurs as well. So, although the microstate picture and statistical mechanics gives us a more thorough and accurate description of our system, in reality making measurements at this scale is way more difficult than measuring large-scale properties like pressure, volume, and temperature. So, we need a way to link our small-scale mathematical model with our large-scale measurable properties. And rather interestingly, our second postulate or second assumption for statistical mechanics says that if our system is in a particular microstate, then we can link this to a particular large-scale property of our system. And we can do that for each of the large-scale properties. Beyond that, it also says that when we make a measurement of one of these properties over some period of time, and we find our gas to have a particular volume, or particular pressure, or particular temperature, this measured value is a weighted average of the individual microstate properties, in this case the weighting being based on how much time our gas happened to spend in each microstate while we were doing the measuring. Sounds complicated, so let's break this down. So, for example, if this microstate corresponds to some volume V1 of our gas, and this is the microstate that our system happened to be in for most of the time while we were measuring the volume of the gas, but then for a short part of the measurement period, it switched to another microstate, which corresponds to volume V2, then our measured value of the volume would be a weighted average of these two values. It would be closer to V1 because it spent more time in V1. As always, I'll leave some resources in the description below because my descriptions in this video are simplified to make them easy to visualize. And of course, things get very complicated once we consider more than even a handful of particles in our system. But anyway, if you enjoyed this video, then please hit the thumbs up button, subscribe, and hit that bell button for more fun physics content. Check out my merch, it's linked in the description box below. It features a quantum dice design based on a famous quote from Albert Einstein. And finally, a huge thanks to all of my Giga patrons and all the others over on my Patreon page. I'll leave a link to that in the description box below as well if you'd like to support me on there. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you very soon.